Hi everyone, and welcome to Impi, your friendly catamaran. For those of you who have not been following us, well, we are a couple, Brent and Anna, sailing around the world. We come from South Africa. We've been sailing pretty much full-time for the past 7 years now on our Lagoon 440 catamaran. Well, I hope you enjoyed the sailing. Difficult to capture the vibe. Now, in our previous video, you saw our daughter Jenna arrive. She flew from Cape Town, South Africa, to Hobart. And we are eager to show her the various sites around Hobart before sailing north for Launceston.
Cool is this?
It's awesome.
Cool, eh?
Yeah.
Very beautiful town.
This memorial is dedicated to Tasmanian commercial fishermen who have lost their lives in fishing activities.
Hobart is a treasure trove of living history, not only at the waterfront area, but here at Battery Point, the oldest remaining building in the vicinity is a semaphore station. It was originally built as a guardhouse in 1818, and later it became a signal station relaying messages from Port Arthur via a similar station on top of Mount Nelson.
This building is the last link in a chain of semaphore stations which from about 1818 transmitted messages until superseded by the electric telegraph. Ship to shore,
answer my call. Oh, that's
well, history abounds everywhere. This house, Ingle Hall, is considered as one of the first multi-story homes built in the Australia colonies and is one of the oldest buildings in Tasmania. It's beautiful.
This old house once knew my children. This old house once knew my wife. This old house.
Well, it wasn't all happy days at Ingle Hall. A plaque on the street makes mention of Maria Risley, a convict who married Edward Lord in 1808 and resided here. Well, she was an active partner in the extensive business interests in the colony, but after their separation in 1824, Maria lost her rights to the property and younger children.
One could go on forever with the history of buildings in Hobart, like this particular building. Constructed in 1905 at the cost of £35,000, the cornerstone was laid in 1901 by the Duke of Cornwall and York, the future King George V. The Commonwealth government, though, refused to fund the tower and bells, saying it was enormous and unnecessary. So, £1,465 were raised by the public. This is no doubt the first recorded example of crowdfunding. It was named the Queen Victoria Clock Tower and opened on the 22nd of June 1906, a year after the rest of the building.
Come on, ladybirds.
You look at the reflection. Mm.
He just went on the slide.
Yeah, that was... Well, sit down, baby. That red wine was good. I have no idea what they're laughing about. No idea. This room just does this to you, man.
Of course, this is art. They even have a wall of vaginas at the Mona Museum. People come from far and wide to examine this art exhibit, which is cast from real women. And if that's not enough to surprise one, well, then you can purchase your favorite sculpture at the Mona gift shop and take it home with you. Cold. That's nice and warm.
Good.
Not that we can see anything out there, it's just white. It's a little bit chilly, eh?
It's a bit chilly, but it's a cool time.
Unbelievable.
I had a dream so big and loud. I jumped so high, I touched the clouds. Whoa. I stretched my hands out to the sky. We danced with monsters through the night. I'm never gonna look back, whoa, never gonna give it up. Please don't wake me now. Oh, 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 this is gonna be the best day of my life.
Just way too much fun. Well, with Jenna spending a holiday with us, we want to see as much as possible. So we set sail from Hobart, bound for the historical Port Arthur. This means sailing down the River Derwent, across Storm Bay, and around the majestic Cape Raoul. Sailing along the shores of the Tasman Peninsula and headed for Cape Raoul is spectacular. The cliffs boast these majestic hexagonal prismatic columns, as if to be lying one against the other, a term used by geologists as columnar jointing. Dolerite columns form this way as a result of the magma cooling from the outside toward the center and surrounded by relatively consistent temperatures. These joints radiate outward from the center of each column, which themselves form perpendicular to the flow base of the magma or lava. It goes on and on.
Arthur was named after George Arthur, the Lieutenant Governor of Van Diemen's Land, the name used by most Europeans for the island of Tasmania before officially being named Tasmania in 1856.
Hey James, what do you think?
Hey, it's awesome.
It's pretty cool, eh?
It's awesome.
James, what do you think, huh?
It's amazing.
Isn't it amazing?
Yeah.
Beautiful little spot that we anchored in, eh?
Port Arthur is steeped in history, where the settlement started as a timber station in 1830, but it is best known for being a penal colony. We touched on this in our previous movies, but Port Arthur had some of the strictest security measures of the British penal system. The penal station initially was a small station in the bush, and around it began certain industries: shipbuilding, shoemaking, steelsmiths, timber and brickmaking. During the 1840s, the industrial penal nature of the settlement consolidated as the convict population reached over 1,100 people. In 1848, a huge flour mill was erected, as well as the construction of a hospital. After the American War of Independence, Britain could no longer send convicts to America, so after 1788, they were transported to the Australian colonies. Most of these men and women were convicted of petty crimes that may seem trivial today, crimes such as stealing small articles, livestock, and so on. They were repeat offenders, and in Britain, this meant that they were going to have a very harsh treatment. As convict numbers increased, the flour mill and granary was converted into a four-story penitentiary. The two lower floors contained 136 cells for prisoners of bad character. The top floor provided space for 480 better behaved convicts to sleep in bunks. In more recent times, tragedy struck here when on Sunday, 28th of April 1996, a young Hobart man armed himself with three high-powered firearms and a large quantity of ammunition.
7 Nightly News with Anne Fullwood.
The shooting spree that's shattered dozens of lives, grief and anger tonight as a nation searches for answers to the slaughter. Good evening. All Australians tonight share the horror of the Port Arthur massacre. 35 people are dead, 18 are injured. Police have now named the mass murderer. He is 28-year-old Martin Bryant, a local man believed to be intellectually handicapped. He's in Royal Hobart Hospital tonight, suffering burns to his upper body after running from the guest lodge that he set alight.
Shortly after lunch yesterday, 28-year-old Martin Bryant systematically mowed down tourists at Port Arthur. 32 were dead by the time he reached the Seascape guest lodge.
I think carnage is the simple way to describe it. It's probably the only single word that I know that would describe what was experienced in there.
Instead of returning with family snapshots of a serene holiday at Tasmania's premier tourist attraction, many people had pictures of a battleground.
People everywhere getting bandaged, just blood. I looked through the window and I saw this lady on the floor, just covered in blood.
Now, just as a follow-on to our animal welfare program, I'm showing you some footage we took today. Yes, today. We are in Well, Via, and thanks to the generosity of so many of you on our social media platform, we were able to pitch in and help Marie, the head of the SPCA in Noumea, to fund this program to sterilize animals free of charge to the local folks who otherwise would not have the means to do so. Thank you so much to all of you for your generosity. We have opened a new GoFundMe account for upcoming animal welfare projects, so please take a look at the link under the description of our video if you wish to assist in some small way. Cheers, everyone, and have a great day.
Let's go play some music.
All right.
All right.
Suntan toes tickling the sand, cold drink chilling in my right hand, watching you sleep in the evening light, resting up for a long, long night. 'Cause when the sun goes down, we'll be grooving. When the sun goes down, we're feeling alright. When the sun sinks down over the water, everything gets hotter. When the sun goes down, yeah. Just taking it easy, laying in a hammock where it's nice and breezy, and sleeping off the night before. 'Cause when the sun goes down, we'll be back for more. When the sun goes down, we'll be grooving. When the sun goes down, we'll be feeling alright. When the sun sinks down over the water, everything gets hotter. When the sun goes down, guitar and my dark sunglasses, this sweet concoction is smooth as molasses. Nothing to do but breathe all day until the big moon rises and it's time to play. When the sun goes down, we'll be grooving. When the sun goes down,